Here, Lord God, to talk about you and talk about your word. Lord, we are asking that you will rend heaven. You will touch every life. You will touch every heart. You will touch every situation. Touch every circumstance. No situation, Lord God, we go back with the owners thereof the same today in Jesus' name. Let the fire fall from heaven. As Lord God, everybody, every worshiper, old timer, newcomer, Lord God, we witness, Lord God, the power of your presence here in this sort of worship this morning in Jesus' name. Speak to us now as we continue. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, we read from verse 12 to verse 14. 2 Chronicles 7, verse 13, rather, through to 14. Very much passage of scripture. Open your Bible. 2 Chronicles 7. We read from verse 13 and from verse 14. If I shut up heaven, that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which I call by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. What I'm sharing with you this morning is God's given conditions to answered prayer. God-given conditions to answer prayers. Many people prayed in the Bible, and many still pray in our contemporary times. People have started praying since the world began, and people will continue to pray till Christ comes. In fact, after the coming of Christ, we will still pray. As I'm telling you right now, some people are praying in hellfire, praying but will never be heard. Some many people also pray in scriptures. Many were heard, some also unheard. Don't make the mistake of thinking that every prayer you saw in the scriptures were answered. No. There are people who prayed in the Bible, and there was no record of answered prayer. For example, Esau prayed. He sought his birthright again with tears, but was not heard. For example, Balaam prayed, let me die the death of the righteous, let my end be like his. He was not heard. He prayed, he wasn't answered. The passenger of Jonah, traveling with Jonah on the sea, sinner Jonah having disobeyed. Jonah traveling in error, traveling in disobedience. And eventually the storm came, and it was windy, it was storming, it was terrible. Just like everybody will die here. And he started praying. And until Jonah was thrown into the sea, they prayed, but they weren't heard. But I pray, as we pray here today, as we pray only, as we pray always, always, we will be heard in Jesus' name. Why were they not heard? One, because they didn't obey. They didn't conform. They didn't fulfill the God-given conditions of answers to prayers. But also, on the other hand, a lot of people prayed the Bible, and they were heard. Abraham prayed. It was heard. In fact, he prayed, his prayer attracted God's promises, and eventually he prayed, there was prayer, there were promises, and then there was performance. And as you pray here today, and as you pray in your closet, and as you pray in the public, anywhere you pray answers, one ultimate objective is the objective of this message, that anywhere you pray answers, you will have answered prayers. I say you have answered prayer. Abraham prayed. He was answered. Elijah prayed, that pot of fire. He was answered. In fact, he was answered in the public. God did not disgrace him. And he got there. Those ones, they were boasting. Those ones, they were making mess of the God of the Jews. And they were the prophet of Baal. And he gave them time to pray unto their God. They prayed from morning till evening unto their own gods. And their God disappointed them. God will not disappoint you. And in case of the time of the evening sacrifice, he brought them together. Come around. They had prayed from morning till evening. 1 hour they were still praying, no answer. 2 hours they were still praying, no answer. 5 hours, no answer. Then about 10 hours, because from morning till evening now, and they have been praying, no answer. And now he was watching. And he said, now come around. He even made it difficult for God to answer prayer the more. He poured water, and water is an enemy of fire. Am I right? And it's very true that God had no limitations. God had no constraints. When it comes to answer prayer, nothing hinders God, nothing opposes God, nothing blocks God. Human beings have barricades. Human beings have limitations. Human beings can come to you and say, please, I'm sorry, I was thinking that this is how it will look like when I was making the promise. But now, as a matter of fact, it's like I can't do it any longer. Those are the statements of men. But when it comes to God, when he says, I will do a thing, there is no wall that blocks God. No barricade that hinders God. No limitation on the way of God. And that is why, whatever you have in your mind, the trouble, the affliction, the sorrow, the difficulties, all your experiences, either though, till now, I pray, as you pray here this morning, God from heaven with his fire will consume them all in Jesus' name. The affliction you brought in here, as you are going home, you will draw them behind, they will be buried here. As you are going outside there, you will see them no longer in Jesus' name. He said, come around. He filled the altar. He filled the meat. And he even cut the offering to me into pieces. Without fire, without matches, without fire lights, without candle, without anything. You know, God can make something out of nothing. And he said, now, told them, so that don't let them know that you are my God, that you are alive, that you exist. That of a truth, you are the only one that should attract our worship and our attention. And fire came down from heaven. The fire licked up the water set of all. And eventually consumed the altar. And from the mouth of those people, themselves, they said, the Lord, it was, is God. People on your behalf, they will give testimony. So there are two categories of testimonies. The testimonies you come yourself and you give. That's not testimony. When your testimony is bogus, when your testimony is big, when your testimony is fat, if your testimony is one in town, if your testimony is astounding, if your testimony is unprecedented, you won't be the only testifier. People that don't even know you, they won't know that you are the one standing. They will say, you know what happened? Someone sometimes. This and this and this, that, and you'll be there. You'll be hearing your own testimony from the mouth of other people. That kind of testimony God will give unto you. The testimony was so big that even the onlookers, the participants, everybody around, they were saying, the Lord is God. Through you, this year, people will glorify God. See it again, 2 Chronicles chapter 7. And there in verse 13, 2 Chronicles chapter 7. Replace me in verse 13. If I sought all heaven, heaven is the giver of all good things. I would say every good thing comes from heaven. If I sought all heaven, if I lock away good things for an individual's life, it is possible that heaven becomes shut up over a family. It is possible that heaven becomes shut up over a community. It is possible that heaven becomes shut up over a campus. In fact, it is possible that heaven becomes shut up over a congregation. It is possible that heaven becomes shut up over an individual life. And it's like there's a blockage, a seal, a brass of heaven over him. When he prays, it's like you are bouncing a ball against the wall. He prays, we hit the wall. Give me the ceiling and we come back. And he prays, the prayer is not ascending. The prayer is not going on. The prayer is not going anywhere. His prayer is not leaving him. His prayer remains with him. So that person has heaven shut up over him. So he says, if that happens to a family, to an individual, to a community, to a campus, to a congregation, if I sought of heaven, that there be no rain, that rain go beyond just physical water. No. Rain brings freshness. If you don't rain for about 9 months, you will be complaining. Am I right? 6 months, you will be complaining. Everything becomes cancelled. In fact, may I tell you, your plants will not grow. When you sow your seeds, the earth will burn it off because it's so hot and dry. There will be no growth. If I shut up heaven, means when there's no growth in the congregation, there's no growth in anybody's life. The way it was 10 years ago, no promotion. Spiritually, no promotion. Physically, no promotion. Professionally, no promotion in your business. No growth, no increase, no fruitfulness. When I shut up heaven, when heaven is shut up, there's no fruitfulness because it's heaven that brings germination. It's rain that brings germination. It's rain that brings up the blaze. And your plants now begin to grow up and bring forth fruits. But when heaven is shut up, go and plant your seed in abundance, it will not germinate. It will die there.
If the rich has managed to grow up, they be withered away and become yellow, then they die green, eventually. When the works of your hand are dire in your presence, heaven is shut over you. So he says, if I shut up heaven, that there be no rain. When there is no rain, there is difficulty in making progress. People who make heaps, farmers, they're not during dry season. The kind of heaps you can make during rainy season, maybe you can make 250 in a day. Some farmers can do that if you ask them. When it's dry season, if you can make 25, then you are hardworking. Your palms will blister. Am I right? And it will be difficult. And when it's difficult to make it in, when progress is becoming difficult, it's like heaven is shut up over you. So you say, if I shut up heaven, that there be no rain, when there's no progress, when making progress, making advancement is becoming extremely difficult, heaven is shut up. When dry season, people become more dirty than rainy season. Right or wrong? Answer me now. There be dust everywhere. When you are falling to sin easily, heaven is shut up over you. This one, you are confessing. After that one, you are confessing. It's like that dust. This one dust all over you. Settling on you. I am not clean. Heaven is shut up. So he said, if I shut up heaven, and there be no rain, when there is no water, no satisfaction. Because when there is no water, no matter what you eat, even when you drink tea, when you drink juice, when you drink Coca-Cola, drink anything, water must be accompanied. Am I right? Otherwise, there will be no satisfaction, no matter what you eat. When satisfaction and fulfillment is eluding you, heaven is shut up. So he says, if I shut up heaven, that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, even the few ones, because there are some plants, botanists told us, some plants can grow even in deserts. Am I right? Baobab tree is an example. And they don't need rain to survive. That even if something accidentally by chance comes to your life, things that are good. He says that I even send locusts. I refuse to allow it to grow. I didn't send water, but it's growing because by nature I've allowed it to grow. He said, again, I send locusts to destroy that. You can't go, die. And if I command locusts to divide the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, whatever category of affliction, category of trouble, of sorrow, of difficulty, of setbacks, of sadness, of stagnancy. He says that if my people, which I call by my name, shall humble themselves, humility in the beginning, and pray, and we pray here this morning, and seek my face. How many people are ready to see God's face here this morning? Yes, I'm looking for those who want to see God's face. Thank you very much. You will find God. You will see God. You will see him early. If they humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will do what? And will heal their land. Heal their land means heal your life. Not until you are sick physically. Well, if you are physically here this morning, God will heal you as well. Heal their land. Heal my life. Heal my lack. Heal my family. Maybe your family is ailing. Maybe your academic is ailing. Maybe your business is ailing. Maybe your profession is ailing. Maybe your job is ailing. Maybe your marriage is ailing. Maybe your spiritual life is ailing. Maybe your ministry is ailing. He says, that's a promise. I will heal their land. But some things are embedded, implicit, in those parts of scriptures. So that if they confess their sins, I will forgive their sins. That's not, they have done something wrong. God is not wicked, that will just touch heaven. God is not wicked, that will send locusts and pestilence. God is not wicked, that will just begin to destroy their work. No, something has happened. But you see that there's a repentance, a restoration, a bringing back, the seeking of my face. Then he says, I will be fond of them, I will forgive them, I will give their land, I will bring back the rain, and whatever you find it you have before, that disappear in your life, good things, this morning, they are coming back. Those other good things you are only be hearing by the ears. You've only been saying loud to other people. You've never witnessed, you've never possessed in your own life. Just be ready. Here this morning, as we pray, they are coming to receive your life in their multitudes in Jesus' name. Book of Isaiah 1. Isaiah 1, don't forget. God given condition of in verse 3. The ox knoweth his owner, and the ass
his master's grave. But Israel does not know my does not know. My people does not consider. Now verse 4. Ah, sinful nation, sinful person. Ah, sinful nation, sinful brother. Antithesis. Sinful sister. A contradiction. Ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, see them that are corruptors. They are forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger. They have gone away backward. There is no need any interpreter to show that the people being addressed here, they once knew the Lord. They were once owned by the Lord. They were once children of God. They were once beloved of God. God once delighted in them, like we say, Galatians, delight. But eventually something happened, and what always happens doesn't begin with God. It is men that often start the change. And when men change, God also changes. Having waited for you to change and come back and you don't change, then God also changes. So he says, they are gone backwards. They were going forward before. They were walking with me before. They were by my side before. They are in my hands before. But now, they are gone backwards. And it's like I speak now, they don't hear me any longer. They are now seeds of evildoers. And they are provoked. The Holy One. God wanted for them to repent. No repentance. They kept doing things as was making God unhappy. He warned them, they won't hear. He called them, they won't answer. And he sent even good people to them to go and speak to them, yet they refused to hearken. And now, eventually, we will see what will follow. Now in verse 15, Isaiah 1, verse 15. And when you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. I pray God will not hide himself from you. What before that individual? They are seeking God and God is hiding. And go from place to place, looking for God, and it's not fan of him. He says, when you stretch forth your hand, when you pray, prayer means stretching forth of hands. I will hide my eyes from you. Yea. When you make many prayers, so if you pray, see that praying through is all about praying long. But you may be wrong. You may pray for 7 days, non-stop, and then I pray through. Some things may be blocking your prayer so long as you're not removing them. God will not answer you. Fast for 21 days unbroken. That's not the center that is sitting in your life will not be answered. Get me right. Praying long is not too bad. It's even good. Spend time with God's presence. I advocate that. That's Bible. But you feel that you have your length of prayer can bribe God or bujus God or unkiss God's hand. To do what ordinarily you won't do because of your lifestyle, it is impossible. So he says, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Why? Your hands are full of blood. You are murderers. Not only murderers, don't just murder physically. The people you murder by your pain, petition, and they lose their job. The people you murder by your tongues, and it's already dead emotionally. It's now dead in integrity. You defame his character. You blackmail him. What he didn't do, you say he had done it. And right now, he's carrying the burden of that trouble, that trauma all around. And you are praying for a situation. God will not hear. He said, your hands are full of blood. Now, in verse 16, wash you, make you clean. This is the condition of answer prayers now. Wash you, make you clean. Put away the evil of your doing from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. That's the condition. When an individual is still doing evil, continuous in evil, incorrigible in evil, and God is speaking, it's not happening, and he's praying, he prays many prayers, but he will never be heard. And it doesn't even have to do with just singing and singing. No, why is this guy disobedient? A Christian. And someone said, God doesn't have disobedient children. Your level of his sonship is the level of your obedience. As men as are led by the Spirit of God, are what? Son of God. Yes. If God cannot lead you any longer, God cannot speak to you any longer,
God, we cannot follow God any longer. Then, who is that shepherd that is laying claim to a sheep and is not in his fold? You are not the shepherd of that sheep. So that if God is your shepherd, if God is your leader, again, God will be able to lead you. And so long as I disobey God in any area of your life, let's do our analysis for 1 year. Let's pray for 1 month. All of us living here, not going anywhere. And so long as you still cherish your evil, you are not ready to be done with your sin. And your sin is still in your pocket. Or you suspend your sin. You know, people say they suspend sight today. That we're not yet through. We are only putting up about 2-3 weeks, watching to see what will happen. If you still keep your sin in the refrigerator, that I will still go by there and pick it. In your physical appearance, you will not see sin any longer in you. But in the innermost being, in the reset of your heart, the thinking and the rhetoric, the decision that, well, let me put it there, I don't know, it's still be using the future. If that is your attitude towards your sin, you have not ceased from doing evil. You say, cease to do evil. And God cannot be mocked. He knows your heart. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever a man soweth, that I hear it. He sees your heart. Person may not know. People may not know. But God knows. And so long as he knows, he could still see that sin in you. And the decision to still go back, still in you. There's no genuine repentance in you. You pray. Do everything. God will not hear. And many times you say, the devil. And you are binding. Bind for 1 year. What will happen? No. Now I've been saying it here many times. Now thank God, you won't be caught of my decision to do it to the devil. Because many things you say devil did, devil knew nothing about them. Devil himself is even surprised that it happened. And you are saying the devil. But thank God is a spirit. Don't come and say, where? You are lying on me. Because you know many of those things. God said that if I send locusts, is that the devil? Answer me now. If I send pestilence, is that the devil? Not the devil. It's the work of your hands. Because your life is bringing evil your way. Judgment of God is falling upon you, and you are saying it's a demon. Not demon, it's you. Demons are innocent about this matter. And the earlier you know that, the better. Cease to do evil. Read it further now. In verse 18, Isaiah 1. Read with me now. In verse 17, learn to do well. We learn it. How will they be converted? We learn the scripture. We learn the word. We align ourselves to the Bible. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve your prayers. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. No oppression, no cruelty, no wickedness. Come now. I'm not calling you for a dialogue. Let us listen together. Fear the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. So they be red like crimson. Pray for me now. That's how your life will be in Jesus' name. 3 circles. Number one, the promises of receiving answers to prayer. The promises of receiving answers to prayer. Number two, possible reasons for unanswered prayers. Possible reasons. Why are people praying? And it's like nothing is happening. Why are people fasting? And it's like there's no answer. Why are people looking for God's will? And God speaks to me, guide me, counsel me, lead me, direct me in this area. And they are devoid of divine counsel. Why? Possible reasons for answered prayers. Number three, the power of righteousness for answered prayer. But number one now, the promises of receiving answers to prayer. Do you have prayer points? Of course, I know you do. Do you have needs? Of course, I mean, I know you do. I know you do. Do you have requests? Of course, I know you do. If you do, the exceeding great promises of God that cover every area of your needs, every area of your request, every area of your life, every area of your body, every area of your problem, every area of your wants. And as you bring those promises to God in prayer, here today and there always, you will begin to witness a new dimension in answer to your prayers in Jesus' name. First of all, I want to forget the promises of receiving answer to prayer. Isaiah 58, in verse 9. Isaiah chapter 58. Read with me there in verse 9. Isaiah 58. In verse 9, then shall thou call, then shall thou pray, and the Lord shall answer. Say better, amen. Thou shalt cry. You know that people, they don't cry in prayer. They pray like a gentle, they pray psychedelic prayer. The prayer of an Americana. And we say pray, his mouth will not move. He just close his eyes. And be meditating there. He's praying his mind. That's not prayer. Really prayer. Say you cry. It's not, I'm not saying that if you pray silent prayer that God will not hear you. But that your soul is crying. You are agonizing in the mind. You are groaning in the spirit. And you are communing with heaven. The deep is logging on to the deep. And it's not the prayer of the superficial. You are not praying on the surface. You are communing, you are groaning. And in fact, you will not even hear you, but you are sweating. You are really before God in His presence. You are forgotten the environment. That is crying. That's agonizing. That's prayer. And that's what God is talking about. Isaiah 58, verse 9 again. There shall thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Thou shalt cry, and He shall say, here I am. As you cry here today, God will say, here I am. If God is not saying, here I am in your life, people will ask, where is your God? But when God says, here I am, then people will be calling to you and say, please, show me, I want to follow to your God. As from today, that will be your own experience. He shall call people, God shall say, here I am. If thou take away from the midst of the yoke. What is the meaning of that? The oppression. You are not oppressing anybody. Women here, you have housemates. You are not oppressing them. Men here, you have drivers. You have messengers in the office. You have subordinates. You are not oppressing them. And you are not, husband here, you are married. You have wives, at home. You are not oppressing them. You have children. You are not embittered. You are not bitter towards them. They are everything being blessed towards your children and being sane and being a disciplinarian and being a serious Christian parent. That's not what I'm talking about now. You say you put away the yoke. Yoke is a symbol, a mark of oppression. You put away in the midst from the midst of the yoke. You are not a body to anybody. You are not troubling anybody. You are not taking away the peace of anybody. You are not taking away the joy of anybody deliberately. You are not making anybody sad or sorrowful deliberately. You are not saying, I will make life difficult for him deliberately. No. You are taking away from the midst of the yoke in the source, in the place of work, at home, anywhere you go. You are not making life unduly difficult for anybody. You are taking away from the midst of the yoke. Now again, still in verse 9. The putting forth of the finger. You are not accusing people. Have you heard what he has done again? See him. Have you heard the story? You are not a backbiter. You don't gossip. You are not spreading people's fault all around. The putting forth of the finger. And again, and speaking vanity. You don't boast. And you say, as a matter of fact, God is really helping us here. But when one was a proud, before God met God, he said, actually, by his grace, he wants to make a proud statement. And then by his grace, none of them is my equal. What are you saying? As a matter of fact, with all humility, I don't belong to anything, so the caliber of any of them. Is that not pride? Speaking vanity. By the time you are doing that, God is saying you are on your own. And withdraw from behind you. So he says that if you want prayer to be answered, you put away from the midst of the yoke. You put in front of the finger. Now come to verse 10. And thou draw out thy soul to the hungry. You are showing mercy. God would be merciful. He also be merciful. And satisfy the afflicted soul. Then shall the light rise in obscurity. You are not saying a good amen. And the darkness be as the noonday. Henceforth, where I be having darkness, light will come there. Where I be having sorrow and sadness, as from this hour, laughter and joy will be your portion in Jesus' name. And the Lord, in verse 11, shall guide thee continually. So that we pray for God's will here. God will guide you continually. You will not make mistakes. You will not marry a regret. You will not marry sorrow. You will not marry sadness. You will not marry a setback. You will not marry a headache. And the Lord shall guide you continually. In your exam, He will guide you. As you are preparing, where to go will guide you. Where to major, God will guide you. Where to check up, God will guide you. And the Lord shall guide you continually and satisfy thy soul in drought. When people are saying that is need, you'll be saying that is plenty. When people are saying, in fact, people fail, we say are fast. Because He will satisfy thy soul in drought and make fat thy bones. And He says, and thou shalt be like a water garden, and like a spring of water, whose waters fail not, and they that shall be of thee shall build the whole waste places. Thou shalt raise up the foundation of many generations. You will not live alone for your generation. There are those whose relevance becomes obscured before they die. They die before their time. They are no more relevant. They are out of relevance even before the end of their days. There are those whose relevance terminates at the end of their days. That's too bad. But there are those who miss the indelible impression of their feet on the sands of time, which nothing forever can ever obliterate. Generations yet unborn, they will know that they have passed through this place. And their names will be sung in the mouth of many people. So they are there, yet they will still be speaking. You'll be one of them. I tell you, you'll be one of them. And it says that you will be sung by many generations. Thou shalt raise up the foundations of many generations. And thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. If thou turn away thy food from the Sabbath. The Sabbath there is talking about time to worship God. They are not running away from fellowship. Some people, they don't come early. They will say, I will see me then in 21. As a matter of fact, by now, the message will not have started. As if worship is all about message. Bible study, pastor wouldn't have come up by now. As if they are coming to meet pastor. As if they are coming to meet God. Singing is part of worship. Prayer is part of worship. Sharing the Bible is in. Reading the Bible is better than beginning. The Bible reading is part of worship. Everything from the beginning to the end. Samuel said, I was glad when they said to me, what? By the time you are dragging your feet, and you are deliberately absenting yourself from fellowship, and you are slowing down, you are sluggish in coming early, then there's no love of God in your heart. And God sees that, and He withdraws. And He says that if thou turn away thy food from the Sabbath, Sabbath is gone. Those are today, worship any longer now. That's what we're talking about. But now for a believer, every day is Sabbath. And particularly, the time of worship. And if thou turn away thy food from the Sabbath, from things that precious on my holy day, call it holy hours. Time of Bible study. That's time you are browsing on the internet. Time of Bible study. That's the time you want to read your newspaper. That's time you want to take your, you feel, now you should relax. Time of Bible study, time of the Bible hour. That is time you want to just go and visit your friends. You are making your clean, your pleasure in His holy day, His holy hour, and call the Sabbath a delight, a free time. The holy of the Lord, honorable, and shall honor Him. Not in thy own ways, nor finding thy own pleasure, nor speaking thy own words. Then shall thou delight thyself in the Lord. Before God would delight Himself in you, you also must delight yourself in the Lord. And I will call it right upon the high places of the earth, and feed thee with the heritage of Jacob thy father. For the mouth of the Lord, other words, has spoken it. In John chapter 15, John 15, read it quickly there in verse 7. John 15. I'm sharing with you now, quickly,
in verse 7. John 15. Now read with me in verse 7. If you abide in me, no sin. You are not living outside of the grace. You are not living outside of the kingdom. Your action, your reaction are in consonance with the scripture. If ye abide in me, and my word abide in you. Can you see that? Number 7. Ye shall ask what you will, what you desire, what you like, and it shall be done unto you. I say it shall be done unto you. It's dangerous not to desire anything. If you desire nothing, then nothing will come. Desire is the beginning. Desire is good. It's not pride to desire something good. It's not humility to live the life of a pauper. You can get to heaven as Abraham got to heaven. Can go to heaven also as Lazarus also got to heaven. They are both in heaven now. Am I right? Answer me now. Abraham is in heaven. Lazarus is in heaven. But by the time Lazarus remember what happened to him on earth, he will regret. Why is that allow all of those things to happen to me? Your life is a choice. Pick one. Pick a bright life. Whatever you desire. And he said, what you will. Will something good. Will something big. Desire something as something. Ask for something great. And what God do for you. You know, even when Lazarus goes to heaven, by the time the rich man was staying in hell, he said, he looked at Pharaoh, he saw Lazarus, said, Father Abraham, he was still thinking it was like before. Same Lazarus. So the earth, why they were on earth? Not maybe because Lazarus was feeding at the foot of the table. He didn't see anybody again to send. He was not out of insult. He didn't say, no, you see your own thing on earth. Now, status has changed. Here on earth, God will send your status. There in heaven also, it will be important. It is your choice. So whatever you will, he said, it shall be done unto you. 1 John chapter 3. 1 John 3. And in verse 21, 1 John chapter 3. Read with me quickly. There in verse 21, epistle. That's the epistle of John. Chapter 3. In verse 21, beloved, if our heart condemn us not. Are you touching your heart? Is your conscience accusing you or excusing you? Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have the confidence. But that condemnation have the confidence. One that's confident, that is faith, that's boldness. To approach the throne of grace, that's why he said, let's come boldly. To the throne of grace. If our heart condemn us, we can come boldly to the throne of grace. Then we have confidence towards God. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him because we keep his commandments and those things that are pleasing in his sight. Chapter 5, that's in the book of 1 John. Chapter 5, now in verse 14. Chapter 5, verse 14. And there's the confidence that we have in him. And if we ask anything according to his will, how do you know his will? Tell you the scripture. Get verses of scripture to know where. I mean, to know what backs up your desire. Check up to see that what you are asking for is within the ambit of desire and the will of God for your life. And he says, if we ask anything according to his will, according to his will, he says, he heareth us. And if not hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desire of him. See that one again, desire. As we petition, as we desire, here and always, you will have your petition. I say you have your petitions. Point number 2 now, possible reasons for unanswered prayers. What if I'm praying, spending many days, spending many nights, I believe in praying well. I believe in praying true. I believe in tarrying at his presence. He's supposed to be disciples. You say what? Prince, you watch with me for 1 hour, ordinary 1 hour, is difficult for you. That means that really, a prayerful life
The beginning of a prayerful life is praying minimum of 1 hour in a day. Because waters are measured, or liquids are measured in liters. Am I right? Distance are measured in kilometers. Am I correct? And is that me? In meters. But time of prayer, they are measured in hours. The quiet time you are doing, you are telling 15 minutes. That's not prayer. 10 minutes. Quiet time. 30 minutes. In this adopted generation, you can't stand. You are telling for 30 minutes and you say you have prayed. No. You are still 1 hour, you are still praying. You say what? Ordinary 1 hour. You can't wash with him. You have been for 3 years now. For just for 1 hour, what? Or hard off? Can't you just wash with him for 1 hour? That is the least expectation for a victorious Christian life. Yes, something has happened once in a while that you may not be able to fulfill that, perhaps. But, and you shouldn't even say that 10 years now, 15 years now, you'll be converted. We sum up the hour, the time of your prayer daily. It's not up to 1 hour. You're not making progress. You are a weakness spiritually. You are spending, you have been in the kingdom for 10, 15 years. You can't be saying, thank God, for some time now. 2 hours, 1.5 hours, 3 hours, I'll be spending in prayer. That's his testimony. And that kind of life, we see it. It's like a water garden. Something is moving. He'll be fresh spiritually. If he admonishes you, the admonition will be fresh. If he prays, there is a result. When you sin, you will see God's presence. You walk all over him. You will see some people. You will even sleep with them for 2 days. You won't know that they are Christians. They haven't committed sin, you know, but it's like it's famished of spiritual grace. You cannot see God's presence all over him. You cannot see God's hands in him. There is nothing that sets him apart. Why? He's not spending time in God's presence. Moses came down from the mount. They couldn't behold his countenance because it was shining. I pray that his presence you will have. I think we have it. But then, to pray long prayer is not all about prayer. Why is that with your long prayers? 7 days prayer and fasting. Why is it your long prayer? 3 days prayer and fasting. In 7 days prayer, vigil. Why is it that with all you are doing, you spend the whole day at home from morning to day, no work, no food, no water. Since you woke up in the morning, since around 6 a.m., you pray till around 8 p.m. in the evening. You leave out of your house while just praying. At times, you mean you will sleep again for 30 minutes, you wake up again, you start praying. You will share your tears, you will work with the enemy, everything. The situation remains the same. Why? Possible reasons for unanswered prayers. Isaiah 59, and then verse 1 to verse 2. Isaiah 59. From verse 1 to verse 2. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened, that I cannot save. And that is ear heavy, that I cannot hear. But it is possible. Not everybody that is there is not answer that now from the question. Get me right. But it is possible. But your iniquities are separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear. Do you commands? Listen to me. I've been coming here now for about some weeks, for some weeks now, for some months now. And thank God we'll be praying here. Maybe out of mercy, God has answered some of your prayers. But may I tell you, that will not continue for long. If you continue your sin, God will turn his back at you. If you refuse to repent, God will cut you in mercy. A time will come, in fact, God himself will show his wrath unto you. So, if you have been praying, and it's like God is not hearing, could it be that God traveled? No, he doesn't travel. Is he blind to your situation? No, he could see. At least he opened your eyes, so he could see. Is that God is deaf? No, he hears. The one that everyone is expressing, the one that's in your mind, just thinking about God sees and hears it. He says he's a silent listener to every conversation, and that is the truth. He hears what you are saying. On the way to the mount, those people they were going, they were sharing, they were discussing. They were bothered, they were difficult, they had difficulty. And they said, look, our hope is shattered. They were thinking we want to be to deliver us for our nation from this kind of captivity. See, and they took him away now. And they buried him, they killed him. Who is he? With cruelty, man didn't do anything. He knew that they were discussing that. Then he came near, that was Jesus Christ. But their eyes were holding, and they were just by their side. They only saw him as a fellow traveler. I think God will open your own eyes. And they will say, what is the problem? Why are you discussing that? Are you a stranger? Where do you come from? You know all that happened in this city? How? And they started telling him his own story to himself. And he also shared with them, taking throughout the whole Old Testament. He said, oh, you fool, and full of heart to believe. Ought not that I have suffered these things and enter into the glory? And he shared with them. Eventually, he broke his dreams, the bread, when they were to eat. In fact, they got to a place. He wanted to wait. There is his sleep. He wants to stop here. Our friend, this is where we sleep. He says, okay, bye-bye. Are you going? Is dangerous? Dangerous to the master? They didn't know. That is very dangerous. So travel this night is dangerous. Please I stay here. Abide with us. It's very dark outside. This road is dangerous. It's okay. I pray you receive a good visitor. This month, a good visitor is coming your way. You will receive a guest of joy. That guest, you see your destiny for good, is coming your way. And as you are just to eat, he just broke bread. And there alone, their eyes became opened. He said, it was the master. Then he disappeared. This morning, God will open your eyes. Sometimes you pray prayer is also because you are not praying revelational prayers. You are praying in your blindness. But when your eyes are open, and you pray the way you also pray, and you pray to target, the answer will come from heaven. But before that, he's talking about iniquity. He said, your iniquity has separated between you and your God. That is why prayers are not answered. Check your life. It doesn't even matter whether you are a newcomer. Even preachers, check your life. Check your heart. Check your depot. Check your disposition. Women here, check the way you meet. You talk. These are days that with all your appearance now, some of us are not different from sinners outside. Backbiting is still there. Gossiping is still there. Wickedness is still there. Sitting between prisoners is still there. You walk between the foot of faith is still there. And so that you have the money. You say, I want to do business. Borrow me this amount. When I see you, now you are doing the business, it's costing you money. And you are making profits. If I report it, it means you're doing it now. Profits will go down. You promise February. And you go to him and say, please, March or April, I will turn it. The market is bad. It's not telling lie now. Market is bad outside. It's flat. God will pray for me. Too late, you need prayer. Prayer of repentance. Prayer that you deceive the king. Because now you are not born again. You pray again. You buy the book. And now the king is also making profits. Now it's April. You are not even begging the person. It's coming this way, you are going this way. And if I can now, one day, he married me, he said, what is the problem? There's no love in our church. No love. If there's love, that if you can give that kind of money, he's a rich man now. He can afford to forget about it. You are a thief. The only thing that remains is now you're waiting on the road to pray this money. That's the kind of Christianity many people are practicing now in the church. You find people now that they are keeping malice. Believers now are keeping something malice. They don't see eye to eye. Don't go online any longer. That is, you say your iniquities has barricaded me from answering your own prayer. Don't look outside. Look inward. Look at yourself, first of all. But as you look at yourself, and as you look around, and you will make a change, then I will open heaven. I said I will open heaven. Isaiah 58 in verse 3. Isaiah 58. Be with me here in verse 3. Isaiah 58. Now in verse 3. Wherefore have you fasted? Say this. And thou fearest not. Wherefore have you afflicted our soul? And thou takest no knowledge. Behold, the day of your fast, you find pleasure. Why are we fasting? And there's no answer. Why is that? I'm going and hungry, and God is taking no notice. But your fasting is not like serious fasting. In your fasting, you should do all your pleasure. Why are you just going on hunger strike? Some of us will fast, we won't pray. No time to pray. They will talk about the new political president, the new election now, you will contribute. They will talk about what is happening in our society, you will contribute. When they are talking about ASU, you are still contributing. When they are talking about what is happening on campus, you will dominate the discussion, and you are fasting. In fact, you will argue and you will lose your voice. And you see, I'm still fasting. And now you are tired. Once, and now you want to go and pray. That kind of prayer, I don't, that kind of fasting, I'm not there. You find your pleasure and exert all your labor to something else, not in prayer. Behold, you fight for strife, argument. You are fasting, no? Because I'm fighting your sins. You'll be in trouble. If you don't know anything, you better don't see that kind of practice, me. I will deal with you here, is fasting. That's a conductor, boss conductor. He said, you fight for strife and debate, argument. And to smile with the feet of wickedness. It's an offer as you do this day to make your voice will be hard on hard. That's not how to fast. I pray it will change. I say it will change. Zechariah 7 and verse 12. Zechariah 7. Read with me in verse 12. Zechariah 7. I'm showing you something in verse 12 very, very quickly. Yea. They made their heart an adamant stone. Let us hear the law. And the words which the Lord holds are sent in the spirit by the former prophets. Therefore, came a great wrath from the Lord of hosts. Therefore, it has come to pass that as they cried, and they will not hear. So they cried, and I will not hear. Said the Lord of hosts. What is that like God is telling you personally? And you are not listening. I am not hearing. I am not happening. What is that thing that God is whispering to us? It will not be a commandment for all. It will not be an issue of shame, of all of hell. God is telling you, it's loud for you, enough for you to hear. You know the details. You understand what God is saying. And you refuse. He said, well, I'm talking, I'm not hearing. When you talk also, when you don't want to talk, me too, I will not hear. I pray, God will hear you. The beginning has been strange. And that is supposed to be done. Ask for grace to do them. And go ahead. When God sees that your man, that you are ready to do it now, then start asking your prayers. At the area of the Bible that you refuse to say, well, every other area I can comply. This other area, don't say to me, no, it's difficult. It's difficult to understand. It's also difficult to obey. And once you are choosing and setting like that, then you are not obeying children. And so, you are not hearing God. He said, you too, he will not hear you. Obedience. Restitution, be free from sin, live a holy life, live a righteous life, then you say something good. Ask in faith, God will hear you in Jesus' name. Proverbs 28, 9 verse 9. Proverbs 28, I'm reading with you quickly in verse 9. Proverbs 28, quickly in verse 9. That turneth away his ear from hearing the law. Even his prayer at the word, abomination. God will turn his face. His prayer will be like terrible odor to the nostrils of the Almighty. And so he will look away. God will not look away from you. As God will not look away from you. Something happened in Israel many years ago. And they were to fight. They've gone away from the Lord. And the Philistines, their sworn enemy, they came around. God often permitted the Philistines to come and deal with them. Like, what are going through now may be a permission of the Almighty to put you to me, to put you, to bring back to even to repentance. And God released the Philistines to deal with them. And they didn't know that the first thing to do is to fight disobedience in their own life. They went presumptuously to the into the battle, into the war. Let me show you what happened. First Samuel chapter 4. First Samuel. Chapter 4. Read very quickly there from verse 1. First Samuel chapter 4. I have no time again. From verse 1 now. And the word of Samuel came to all Israel. Now Israel went out against the Philistines. This is how I have spoken to them. They won't happen. The prayer of God spoke to them. They won't happen. And now they went out against the Philistines to battle. I think we're not fighting disobedience. All those say, I bind you. As you have made that you are saying. How many times has the binding works? You bind. Satan, I subdue you. Has he been subdued? Before he says, I'll be praying. All the banding and the loosening, all the loosening in me, what have been the effect? Something is wrong. And something was wrong with the Israelites. And so they went out against the Philistines to battle and pitched beside Ebenezer. And the Philistines pitched in Aphek. And the Philistines put themselves in array against Israel. And when they joined battle, Israel was smitten before the Philistines. And the slew of the army in the field, how many? About 4,000 men. That happens many times. Something have happened to unbelievers. They're wondering, how come a son of God, let that son of God take up his fame himself? But am I sure I'm right with God? If you are right, then let's face the battle together. Maybe we should join you in prayer. But second, I feel all right. These things were all right with them. Between them and God, they went precipitously. Again, the Philistines, they were smitten. About 4,000. And me, between them, they said something was wrong. Let's go back. Let's go and repeat here. Let's retire and fire. And when the people were come to the camp, the elders of Israel said, wherefore had the Lord spoken us today before the Philistines? Thus fetch the ark of the covenant of the Lord out of Shiloh unto us. Now when it cometh among us, it may save us out of the hands of our enemies. Ark of God is not a magical instrument. You are sinning, you are praying. And you are bad and you are losing. I see your fasting and your prayer will do some magic. No! God has a procedure. They went, they fetched the ark of God's covenant. There were 10 commandments inside the ark of God's covenant. They didn't obey the commandments inside the ark of the covenant. But they want the ark of the covenant to be effective and effectual on their behalf. It doesn't work that way. And they brought it near now. And so they put them to Shiloh. And they might bring from thence the ark of the covenant of the Lord of hosts, which were between the cherubims and two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas. We are there with the ark of the covenant of God. And when the ark of the covenant of the Lord came into the camp, all Israel shouted with a great sound. They were saying, yes, now we have power. Hey, authority has come. Now we deal with them. And so that the earth rang again. And when the Philistines heard the noise of the shout, they said, what made the noise of this great shout in the camp of the Hebrews? And they understood that the ark of the Lord was coming to the camp. And the Philistines were afraid, for they said, God is coming to the camp. Unfortunately, God was not there. And they said, woe unto us, for there had not been such a thing we are here so far. Woe unto us, who shall deliver us unto the hand of this mighty God? These are the God has made existence with all the place in the wilderness. Be strong. We must fight. It is in fact that God will deal with us. But what they say before we die, we'll do something. Be strong. And to yourself like men, oh you Philistines, that if you not strong of the Hebrews, as they have been to you, put yourself like men and fight. And the Philistines fought. And Israel was smitten. And they fled every man into his tent. And I was against a very great slaughter. For there fell of Israel, how many? That's out of footmen. When the ark was not there, about 4,000. The ark now came. The ark even helped the Philistines to slay them. About 30,000 footmen. And even the ark of God was taken. And the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were slain. There are things that God refused to work. And if you get as if God is doing his own shame, people will be assaulting God and why is God allowing this? Yes. God will temporarily endure the insult of the unbelievers, of the heathen, because of you. When you have gone away backwards and pray all the prayers, do all the fasting, nothing may happen. What is God asking? Asking for repentance. Asking for restoration. Asking for restitution. Then come and make your prayers. And pray fervently and that effectually. You say, He will hear. And will hear you in Jesus' name. Fortunately now the promises. Fortunately now the power of righteousness for answered prayers. Power of righteousness for answered prayers. Now the prayer I show you, time is gone now. Just one or two places now. And then we pray. 1 Kings chapter 18. 1 Kings 18. Number 36. 1 Kings chapter 18. Leave me there, brother. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel. Let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel. In your life this day it will be known. God will say himself mighty on your behalf. And that I am that servant that has done all these things at thy word and obeys you. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that these people may know the good of God, that thou art the Lord God, that thou hast turned their heart back again. 38. Then the fire of love fell. Here this morning, the fire will fall. And consume the burnt sacrifice, and the wood, and the stones, and the dust, and lifted the water that was in the trench. And when the people saw it, they fell on their faces. And they said, the Lord, he is the God. The Lord, he is what? He will be a testifier. I say he will be a testifier. In this exam, you will testify. Those of us that are in the examination of life also, you will testify. You are going through one trial or difficulty, you will testify. All the troubles in your life, they bow down to the power of the Almighty God here this morning. In Jesus' name. The fire fell. And when the fire falls, it's not falling for nothing. When the fire fell, something happened. The fire lit the water, burn the sacrifices. Everything you will lay on the altar today, except you don't mention them. Anything we mention here today, anything we do, you will pray. Anytime you pray here this day, as you lay them on the altar, fire of God will come. Drop all your requests, all your burden, all your trouble, all your affliction, all your sorrow on that altar here this morning. Put them there. And as you put all your points, all your requests, all your needs, all your burden, all your sorrows, all your troubles, all your afflictions, all your setbacks, and you put them on the altar, as they come from heaven, if you consume them and vanish away, in Jesus' name. Don't feel like you got in and you can't wait. As you are going here, God will occasionally permit divorce between you and your afflictions, in Jesus' name. All your complaints, all your reproaches, what did people see in you? And they are saying, where is he going to show us? He's going to answer his prayer. That kind of complaint, those comments, it will end here. It will cease now. I say it will cease now. Because this promise, where are they from? I'm going back there now. If I short of heaven, that there be no rain. He said for that point, he said, now my ears shall be attentive to the prayer that you pray in this place. If I short of heaven, that there be no rain. Or if I send pestilence and locusts to the body, if I send locusts to the body, the land, or I send pestilence among my people, if my people who shall come by my name shall humble themselves, they won't say I'll be good at a long time. They won't say I've been a leader, I've been a worker, I've been a preacher, I've been anything, I know all that they are saying. They will humble themselves before God, not before the preacher, before God, and they talk of their wickedness, and they will confess, and they will repent. If they have anything wrong in their life, they will align it and straighten it up and pray. And the first of you say, I will hear them, I will hear them, I will heal their land. Are you ready for healing here? Listen, something used to happen. When I went to my primary school, I don't know where I see happening now, in the afternoon, you know, in the morning at the assembly. Am I right? Then they will beat some drums. I don't know where I see it now. And we match our classes. In the afternoon, they will come. After the headmaster has finished addressing us, whether it's happening in your school, many of you here, maybe it's not happening in your school, you are not coming. It's not happening in your school again, I don't know. But not students, are you hearing me now? Say amen. If you're hearing me. They will say, and the headmaster will finish the question and say, now, dismiss. What will happen? He will say, hooray, and you go away. Is that what will happen in your school? They will say, dismiss. That is what I want to say. All the assembly of your trouble, of your affliction, of your difficulty, of your stress, of your trouble, of your setback, here this morning, you will say, dismiss. And when they dismiss, just then they carry their belongings, they go home. They are no more there. Come back there for 5 minutes. We won't find a single bed. We won't find a single student. They go away. As I say dismiss here again, all your troubles, they will dismiss. They will disappear. Failure, dismiss. Carryover, dismiss. Problem, dismiss. Stagnancy, dismiss. Sickness, dismiss. Failure, dismiss. Poverty, dismiss. Unhappiness, dismiss. Falling to sin, dismiss. Every assembly of trouble, dismiss in Jesus' name. Last man, I now pray, tell God, dismiss. All my trouble, dismiss. All my sorrow, dismiss. All my setback, dismiss. All my sadness, dismiss. All my failure, dismissed. All my lack, dismissed. All my need, dismissed. All my want, dismissed. If I shut up heaven, that there be no rain. Or if I send locusts to the body land, if I send pestilence from among my people, if my spirit has sent me that come in my name, that humble themselves and pray, then will I hear from heaven. I will heal your land. So my prayer is a serious person. Dismiss. Dismiss. What will dismiss you? I become dismissed. What will ban on earth, I will ban in heaven. What will root out, I will root out. What will destroy, I will destroy. What will plant, I will plant. Say dismiss. Say them dismiss. Sadness, dismiss. Celibacy, dismiss. To go in order, no one to marry, dismiss. No one got to marry, dismiss. No job, dismiss. No forget, dismiss. No promotion, dismiss. No affluence, dismiss. No growth, dismiss. No fruitfulness, dismiss. Sadness, dismiss. Dryness, spirituality, dismiss. Not tell them every day, dismiss. Tell it, dismiss. Tell it, dismiss. By the authority of the word of God, say dismiss. Say dismiss. They will disappear. They will disappear. We shed the hero here. There's money with here. Are you really paying? Are you really paying? If you don't say dismiss, then you are lying. It. Everything you lay on the altar, everything you bring here, everything you assemble here, whatever you drop here, God takes them away. Whatever you lay on the altar, whatever you are dropping here, whatever you are dropping here, whatever you are dropping behind, it's not going with you. Here is being buried. It's been taken away. It's been annulled. It's been destroyed. It's been removed. Prayerlessness, dismiss. Stagnancy, dismiss. Lack of revival, dismiss. Whatever is pertaining to your joy, dismiss. Dismiss. Failure, dismiss. Sickness, dismiss. Wealthy spending, dismiss. No assistance, dismiss. 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 If I shut up heaven, can there be no rain? If heaven shall be against you, no refreshing, no fulfillment, no progress, no fruitfulness, no growth, no increase. If I shut up heaven, can there be no rain? Can there be rain? Let the rain. Rain heaven, O God. Rain heaven. Rain heaven. Rain heaven. Rain heaven. Pray as an individual to worship the open heaven. Pray as an individual to worship the open heaven. In Jesus, it is away from heaven. Rent heaven. Rent heaven. Rent heaven. Rent heaven, O God. Tear heaven apart. Open the door of heaven. Knock, knock hard. I don't appreciate the way I pray. Not hard. Cry unto God. When you cry, say the answer. Not heaven, not heaven, not the door. Whatever you ask, you will receive. Ask and you shall receive. Seek, you shall find. Knock shall be open unto you. Now he will be lighter than you, then heaven. Then heaven, O God. Then heaven, O God. All this locked door, they will be opened. Locked door, be opened. Locked doors, be opened. Knock hard, knock hard, knock hard. Keep knocking. Keep knocking, keep knocking. Keep knocking. Keep knocking, keep knocking. In this moment, hour of breakthrough, hour of peace, hour of progress. If your peace disappeared, you can find your peace back. If your joy disappearing, your joy can be brought back. Here is your prayer. Knock hard, knock more. Pray better, pray better, pray better. No change there, you can't pray. Don't pray us, but don't feel like gentlemen. And that's why you're playing all this kind of a gentleman prayer. You can't pray. Don't feel like men. Pray hard and pray hard. Pray actively. It's a serious moment. Everybody is praying. We ask not because we ask not. Ask is going to be filled. If anything can be with your own joy here, go away to do by your joy. Your joy is coming. Your joy is resuming. Your joy is happening. It's the beginning of your joy. Anything and only your peace and only prayer. Call it off. Remove it. Destroy it. Output it. Pray more, pray more, pray more, pray more. Are you praying? Those of pieces and they are really praying. Everybody be on your feet. Everybody be on your feet and really pray. Everybody be on your feet and pray. So last moment. Everybody be on your feet. Keep praying. Knock the door, knock hard. Knock heaven. Knock heaven. Knock heaven. Knock heaven. What do you want for your life? What do you want for your future? What do you want for now? You can write the history of your life. And I'll be a new beginner from today. God has begun to open your way. Can be happier than ever before. Can be holier than ever before. Can be more victorious than before. Pray more, pray more, pray more, pray more. It's a serious moment. It's a serious moment. We are trying to desire. When you pray, shall receive. Pray more. Keep praying. Pray more, pray more, pray more. Is that how much you can pray? Is that all you need? For your family? For your parents? For your disciples? For your spouses? For your children? Is that all you can do? Hour of blessing. Hour of mercy. Hour of grace. Hour of joy. Hour of happiness. Hour of breakthrough. Hour of testimony. It's here now. It's here now. It's here now. If you don't receive, it's your fault. If you don't receive, it's your fault. Repent of every man's sin. Every iniquity drop them. Every iniquity drop them. If I hide any iniquity in my heart, no one will hear me. And it's going to be done. Promise what you will do them. Prepare your mind to do them. Ask God to do them. Align your heart with the word of God. Tell them to forgive all your sins. To cleanse you. To make you righteous. To make you right with Him. Pray more, pray more, pray more, pray more, pray more. Are you praying now? Are you praying now? Are you praying now? Don't, I'm not stopping you. Don't pray less. Keep praying. It's in your hand. It's in your hand. It's in your hand. What you ask is what you receive. If you don't ask, you won't receive. Desire nothing and have nothing. Ask for rest of mind. Peace of God Almighty. Joy of the Holy Ghost. Do you have them? Are you rested in your spirit? Does God speak to you? Ask for the power to pray. In the closet, power to pray. And nothing to pray. Start of breakthrough. Pray more, pray more, pray more, pray more. Tell us, serious people.
Overcoming, amen. A peace, amen. Breakthrough and success, amen.
That which is making you happy will not disappear. The object of your joy will not be taken away.
That which is making you going, making you fulfilled, and you will not see it away in Jesus' name. As from this morning, you are anointed for service.
Oil of breath right now is put upon you.
Here in this place of prayer, the host of heaven, God of heaven, is occasioning a permanent divorce between you and your affliction in Jesus' name. All the troubles, all the sorrows, all the setbacks, all the stagnancy, here this morning, the yes are broken in Jesus' name. That hanging calamity, hanging sadness, hanging evil, what to happen? By the sword of the Holy Ghost, they are cut away in Jesus' name. That height, you don't even imagine. What do we expect? Testimony you are not anticipating. They begin to come now to your life in situation in Jesus' name. Evil henceforth will not visit you. That repose is taken away. That sadness is aborted. And from now onward, what you are looking back and you are seeing, and you are sighing and you are afraid. Right now, they are burning the Red Sea in Jesus' name. Where you have been rejected before, now you are going back there, you'll be accepted. Anywhere you go right now, favor of the Almighty. Any door you stand before even right now, they will open before you. Whatever you lay your hand up now, henceforth, they will begin to prosper that your input in Jesus' name. Where there be no rain, now that is collected ample.
There will be erosion. That is full of water, that is running water,
and the source of your trouble now is dry off in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you because you hear prayers. There are promises of the scripture. If I sort of heaven, that there be no rain, or if I send locusts to devour my people, or if I send pestilence among my people, for every of those terrible evils, there are promises. Lord, I am praying, whatever evil that has happened in now these people, by their sin, by their iniquity, by their carelessness, by their prayerlessness, by the incursion of the enemy, here, right now, we stand together, corporate anointing, with your faith, and let the Holy Ghost, power the word of God, and because of your blood, right now, we send them away in their lives, in Jesus' name. Lord, I am asking, here today, turn their shame to glory in Jesus' name. All the strength of failure, all the strength of calamity, stagnancy, setback, sorrow, sadness, here this day, Lord God, we turn the strength in Jesus' name. In the order of the Egyptian host, as they die in the Red Sea, Lord, we are praying, all their sorrow, they will be buried here and they will die here now in Jesus' name. As the Israelites saw no more the Egyptians throughout their wilderness experience, Lord, I'm asking, in their pilgrimage on earth, all they have uttered, all they have mentioned, even the one they didn't even remember to mention, the one they can even not even mention, hey, Lord God, I pray, they will go out there, they will see them no more in Jesus' name. What they will do that will hinder your blessing, Lord, I pray,
take it out of their lives to Jesus. That miracle they are expecting. Their prayer point has been there for a long time. Lord, I pray and announce now for your people that testimony is come. That joy is come. Your hour of prayer is come right now. Lord, let all of them testify to Jesus the God in Jesus' name. Make your people happy. Don't let me examine what I pray this week that they walk over. Give them testimony. The one that they don't, testimony. The one ahead of them, testimony. Everybody here, every area, testimony. As I go to your house now, testimony. In your place of work, testimony. Where you're traveling, testimony. In the source, testimony. We be testified together in Jesus' name. Thank you for your honor, prayer, God. In Jesus' name, we pray. Happy Amen. Happy Amen. God bless you.